Good morning, all. Welcome to Court Street Baptist Church this morning, and thank you for joining us as we gather in this very special place of worship to bring glory and honor to our Lord and Savior, the Christ Jesus. Before we continue, we have a few announcements that have to be made here this morning. 11 a.m. this morning, adult Sunday school in a vestry led by Flo and Air, and this evening at 6 p.m., interactive study Bible led by Pastor Jim Grumbine, I believe in the book of Genesis. Also, Tuesday, 6:30 p.m. this week, church council meeting. The gorgeous flowers you see on this table here this morning, in memory of 10 Reynolds from all the Reynolds, they're beautiful. There is a memorial service for Randy Whitehouse. It's scheduled for Saturday, May 29th at 11 a.m. This will be held at High Street Cemetery, South High Street in Bridgeton, Maine. That is May 29th at 11 a.m. At the bottom of the announcement list, there are two names for directory updates. I would bring that to your attention. Joy Ramsey and Leslie and Judy Johnston. It'd be great to send them a card of just how you doing. It'd be great to communicate that to them. And next Sunday evening, May 30th, there will be a special service at 6 p.m. to honor the memory of those of our congregation who have passed away during the past 2 years. That's next Sunday evening at 6 in the sanctuary. If you are able, could you please stand for the invocation and the Lord's Prayer? At the bottom of your bulletin, first page bottom, would you join me in reading of God's word here this morning? I'll read the first verse and would ask the congregation, if you would please, to read the two after. I will exalt the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips.
I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together.
And everyone said,
Amen.
Let's pray. How grateful, how thankful we are, Lord, that we can be in this place here this morning. Amongst the busyness of life, amongst the chaotic times of life we all experience, but yet we have time to be here. Let us take a moment just to quietly reflect on our Lord and what his son Jesus has done for us here today. Thank you, Father, for the time to worship. May all that we do in this very special place, from our songs and from our hearts and from the words that we say, bring glory and honor to you today. We pray all this in the holy, precious name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please take your insert for the morning songs? Kathy will play through Praise the Name of Jesus and the first line of the doxology.
Praise the name.
For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to your name, O Lord, glory to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to your name, O Lord, glory to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. You may be seated. Many of you have come to the Wednesday night gatherings. We can't do that for a little while, but you've sung this song many times. Kathy would like you to join in if you'd like to. That's why we praise him.
He came to live a perfect life. He came to be King and friend. He came to heal and show the lost ones his love. He came to go prepare a place for us. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship his King. 'Cause he gave
Scripture reading this morning will be from 2 Peter. I was thinking about Peter and thinking that in the Bible, there's hardly a person that has gone from very immature, raw material spiritually, to such an advanced spiritual person as Peter. Peter's a wonderful example of what God can do. I'm beginning to read at verse 1. We're going to read all of 2 Peter chapter 3. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming?" He promised. Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has from the beginning of creation. But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being, and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives. As you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming, that day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with this promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation, just as our dear brother Paul also wrote you with the wisdom that God gave him. He writes the same way in all his letters, speaking in them of these matters. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do the other scriptures, to their own destruction. Therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. I'll just make a footnote thought here that just has to do with this passage and nothing to do with the message later on. But to my knowledge, this is the only scripture where one apostle defends another and his writings. And Peter says, I know Paul says some things that are hard to understand, but what he's saying is good. And I often wondered why that was in the Bible. Why did Peter say that? And as I have served as a pastor over the years, I've seen more and more people who criticize things Paul said, either because they didn't understand them or because the enemy of the church was just trying to stir up discord and discontent. And so if there's any person in the Bible that I have seen as a pastor that people have argument with their words, it's Paul. So I think it's very interesting that Peter defends him. Let's pray together. Our Lord and our God, we've gathered today and we recognize your presence. You are here. We see it. We sense it. We know it. Thank you for this church. Thank you that you're present in it. Thank you for the worship that we've already experienced. I pray, Father, that even though this is a corporate worship experience, and we want to focus on it and appreciate it in that way, we also recognize that we have individual needs. And so, Lord, I pray that you would touch us and bless us and help us, bring healing, bring hope, bring a spiritual uplift to everyone present who needs it, and those who are part of our church and extended families who are not here today. We pray that you would be a God in their homes and in their lives in special ways this week. But now, Lord, as we continue to worship, bless us and teach us individually and corporately. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen.
If you are able, please stand and take your insert. We will sing Thy Word. Always reminds me of Gene Walden.
This is a great opportunity for me to say thank you to all the prayer warriors that are here and that are at home who've been praying for me. I'm also very croaky this morning. I don't know where that came from, but anyway, some good things have happened because of your prayers. A couple of things that could have been wrong with me seriously are off of the table. That's good. I've connected with the only physician in town who accepts new patients, and she is awesome. On the downside, there's a whole bunch of things that could possibly be wrong that are going to be investigated and checked out, and I'm going to need more prayers. I didn't want to see that long list of possibilities, but that's the way it is. So during these many, many months of my struggle, besides your prayers, I've gotten into the habit of singing to myself, which I used to do a lot, but I do more of now. And I use a lot of the songs that we've put into the healing and uplifting music ministry folders that we take to people. And oftentimes at night, because I have a big sleeping problem, I do switch into song. And what's been amazing is many of the times that I choose a song, it turns into the song I'm going to sing today. For some reason, it's become very medicinal, very comforting. So I chose that for today. I have a lot of other songs that I could have done, but because Pastor Jim went so long with the scripture reading and his little anecdote after, I'm going to just stay to this one song, if that's okay. I didn't want any blowback from singing too many songs. The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me beside quiet waters too. Goodness and mercy all
shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be.
Well, if you want to follow along, I'm going to read a short passage of scripture from Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, first six verses. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say, 'You must not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, 'You must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die.'" "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. The first sin of humankind was the sin of unbelief, I am convinced. Now, if asked the question, what is the very first sin? We'll usually say, well, Eve took the fruit and ate it, and then Adam ate it, and it was the taking of the forbidden fruit. And books have been written and plays have been written, all using the metaphor of the forbidden fruit. But people will say that's the first sin. But I'm convinced that unbelief was the first sin, was the sin that was in Eve's heart, plus several forms of coveting and self-justification that all kind of came simultaneously in Eve's heart before she ever touched the fruit. And I'd like to talk about that this morning and the process of sin in the human heart. Let's pray together again. Father, I realize that it's a profound privilege to speak your word and to speak about your word to other people. It's important that we understand it, and we want to understand it and be guided by your Holy Spirit, because this word came to Moses' pen by the Holy Spirit and has been translated into English and now sits before our eyes, and we're going to talk about it and think about it. And I pray that that same Holy Spirit that guided it to be written in the first place would guard our hearts and minds so that when we speak about it and think about it, we get it right. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So unbelief is like the fertile ground for many other sins. And I'm not saying that it's impossible to sin without some form of unbelief to be there first. I haven't really exhausted that theory or that thought process in the Bible, but I think unbelief in God is there at the basis of virtually every sin we commit. And let me explain. I think this is a word that is bigger than just when somebody tells us something that we can't fathom or we just don't accept it. We say, I don't believe that. And we say that's unbelief. But I think unbelief in God is a broader thing. I think the reason the Bible spends so much time pointing to unbelief is that it is the basis, it's the foundation of so much other sin. When we discount that God means what he says, when we discount that God will act upon his word, when we discount the fact that God is a being of integrity who says something and expects us as human beings to respond, unbelief says, I don't really think God will respond in the way that he has said. And essentially, I think that's the beginning of Eve's problem and the human race's problem, which comes from this first sin and many sins that followed. I'm turning now to the book of Hebrews chapter 3, and I want to read a few verses from there. Hebrews chapter 3, I'm reading beginning at verse 12. And look especially for unbelief. The writer of Hebrews says at verse 12, see to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the end. As has just been said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. Who were they who heard and rebelled? Were they not all of those Moses led out of Egypt? And with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies perished in the wilderness? And to whom did God swear that they would never enter his rest, if not to those who disobeyed? So we see that they were not able to enter because of their unbelief. So the writer of Hebrews also connects disobedience broadly with the basic sin of unbelief. The first thing that Satan did when he was conversing with Eve is he deceived her into disbelieving God. He replaced her reliance upon God with doubts. She had not considered to doubt God up to that point. Adam had not considered to doubt God up to that point. Deception and unbelief was not part of the equation in the Garden of Eden up to that point. God had said, you are free to eat any tree in the garden. Listen to what God has actually said to her. This is back in chapter 2. He said to Adam and Eve, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die. You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat of it, you will surely die. Satan's argument begins with a question to put a matter that God has stated in doubt. He's saying to Eve, did God really say? Or, you know, as we would say today, really? Really? Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? Is that what God said? No. He's saying, did God say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? So the first thing is there's a question to put the matter in doubt. He's questioning God's truthfulness. And then He's confusing the facts. Did God say, don't eat from any tree? No, that's not what God said. God said, you may eat from any tree except that one. And so Satan first puts the question to Eve to create doubt, and then he confuses the facts. And third, there's a direct challenge of God's veracity. You will not surely die. Come on. You won't surely die. So he puts a question of God's veracity in Eve's mind to create her, to create doubts, and then he confuses the facts and indicates that God had said you can't eat from any tree. And then third, there's a direct challenge of God's veracity. You will not surely die. And then finally, he assigns some underhanded motive to God. Look at it in verse 5. He says, for God knows that when you eat of it, God is being underhanded with you, Eve. God knows that when you eat of it, you will be like him, assigning selfishness to God. God doesn't want to share moral wisdom with human beings. That's the implication. You don't have to believe God. And didn't God say that you shouldn't eat from any tree in the garden? And then he says, you will not surely die, as God said. And then he says, here's God's motive. God doesn't want you to be as smart as him. And so all of that in just a sentence or two. So Eve was deceived to have unbelief in God's word and God's character. And she fell because of her unbelief. And probably at least several other sins were born out of that unbelief and occurred in Eve's heart before she ever touched the fruit. What were those sins? Well, I think they were probably the universal lusts that John, the apostle, gives us in 1 John chapter 2. So if you want to follow that, you're welcome to do so, or you can just listen as I read. 1 John chapter 2. He is warning the church in verses 15 and 16. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 and 16. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. And that verse 16 again, for everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. So they're pretty much remain the same no matter what translation you have. King James said also the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. So what are those? Observe the sequence unfolding in the commission of these sins. Eve listens to the deceiver, and disbelieves God. Having now no standard to hold on to, if God is a liar, Satan has put the notion in her heart that God is a liar. So if God is a liar, therefore he can't be relied upon, and now I have no standard. So long ago when we pulled the Bible from our culture and we began to say, this is not the standard for everybody. Everybody lives by their own truth. And then we began to become more and more like the days of Noah, in which everybody did what was right in their own eyes because nobody has a standard. And that's the culture that we live in firmly today. But Eve listened to the deceiver and disbelieved God, and now she has no standard if even God is a liar, if you understand what I'm saying. Eve is now drawn into these three areas of lust and covetousness. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food. Now, is it wrong to look at food and say, that's good? That's going to taste good? that's not going to taste good. No, there's nothing wrong with that. But she's allowing the desire for a normal human craving or want to be distorted against God. And when that happens, she's now fallen into sin because she wants that so much that she's willing to defy God to obtain it. And she has crossed the line from what is normal human desire into rebellion. So when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, that's the lust of the flesh, craving for taste, and it was pleasing to the eye, it was pretty, it looked good. And it's okay to look at a piece of fruit or something that you would like to have in your life or buy or bring into your home or grow in your garden. There's all kinds of things that we can look at and say, this is very beautiful, God. I would love to grow some beautiful roses or whatever. But when the beauty of something, when the glitz of something becomes so strong in me that I covet it, and my covetousness is willing to push me to defy God, I've crossed the line. So Eve is hungry, and it looks good to eat, but she crosses the line and is willing to be disobedient. And the fruit looks good, it's beautiful. But to obtain it, she's willing to cross the line and be rebellious against God. And now the pride of life kicks in, this third lust that John talks about. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. I will know as much as God if I eat it. So did Eve stop and spend a half an hour thinking through all those things? No. It happened in an instant. I want that. I want that more than I want to obey God. It's beautiful. I want to obtain it more than I want to obey God. It's going to make me as smart as the Almighty. And God's keeping it from me for that reason. So I cross over once, twice, three times perhaps in rebellion, and I'm buying into Satan's lie, so there's unbelief. There's unbelief, and there's covetousness. There's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And that's all before she took the fruit. That all happened in her heart, or some combination of that, because that's the process of sin, and the apostles of God and the writers of the Bible describe that process, and that's what John's doing in 1 John chapter 2 that we just read. The pride of life says, I'll know as much as God, and I will become so much more important. I think that all three of the universal sins mentioned by John were present in Eve's mind before she ever touched the fruit. And those three sins are the three main temptations that Satan tempted Jesus with in the wilderness as well. If you take those and hold them up against the temptations of Jesus and examine them, those are the processes that Satan used to tempt Jesus. It's not sin to have wants and wishes. It is wrong when these cross the line and become corrupt. All of these sins in succession and virtually simultaneously occurred before Eve ever touched the fruit. And I'm sure it worked that way with Adam as well. Unbelief that God meant what he said, craving of the flesh, it was good for food, and I have to have it regardless of what God has said. An attraction of the eyes, it was beautiful, and I have to have it regardless of what God has said. And pride of personal importance, my own importance and my own ability to discern is going to be given to me if I eat that fruit. even though God has forbid me, I'm going to eat it anyway. And then, of course, Eve touched the fruit. She took it and ate it. Often, a long time before you and I actually commit an act of physical sin, a process of sin development has taken place in our mind and in our heart. There are seeds of unbelief which are sown by someone or something, some event, something we've read, something we've heard. And we listen to it and we begin to believe that somehow God doesn't really mean what he says. And so we begin this process of self-justification. And we come up in our minds with all kinds of reasons why God doesn't really mean what he has said. So the Bible, for example, teaches us that Christ is coming again. The Bible teaches us, Christ taught us in the Olivet Discourse in the later chapters of the book of Matthew. Christ taught us over and over and over again to be ready, be ready, be ready, be ready for his return. What is it that keeps us from living like we are expecting it at any time? Why don't I go home this afternoon and pull up a cup of coffee and think about Jesus coming back and how I should behave this afternoon in light of that? Why don't I do that more? I'm not saying I don't do it at all, but I don't do it often enough. And I will confess that. Why don't we do that? It's because we have essentially seeds of unbelief. And that's what Peter's addressing in the passage we read earlier. He's saying, people are saying everything has gone on as it has from the beginning. Where is this promise of his coming anyway? Where is he? And Peter is saying, it's because we don't remain mindful of the fact that the earth which was once drowned in the deluge is going to be burnt up with a fervent heat, and sinners are going to a horrible eternal place called hell, and the redeemed are going into God's bosom and into his blessing and to live with him forever. Why aren't those things in our minds and driving our behavior and the way we live? It's because we human beings have listened to the snake. And we have seeds of unbelief that keep us from really living as though we believe God. Now, he does that in different ways to each of us. Satan has a custom written plan to mess you up and to mess me up, because he knows exactly who we are. The truth is, most of us would make major adjustments to our behavior and priorities if we really believed Christ would come at any time. So suppose this is a very facetious thought, but suppose the minister this morning is not Jim Grumbine, but the angel Gabriel. Now, he was pretty good at predicting everything throughout the Bible. We see him pop up in Daniel chapter 9. He's way back there in the book of Daniel. He's in the New Testament a number of places. He has to do with the end time events. He has to do with the nativity events. He has to do with the prophetic events in the Old Testament. So everything Daniel ever predicted came true. Or that Gabriel ever predicted came true. So suppose Gabriel came to you or stood here and said, this afternoon at 3:17, the Lord is returning. And it was very credible. Now, we know that we're not going to know the day and the time. I know. So some of you already thought that. Just, you know, erase that. But if you knew the time, that's what I'm saying. If you knew the day and the time, what would you do? You would spend the time between now and 3:17 praying and making sure that everything you could confess was confessed. You'd clean up your minds, you'd clean up your homes, you'd clean up everything that could be cleaned up, and you would make things ready for the Lord. But the evidence of the biblical writers is that the Lord can come at any moment. So the imminency of that coming is proposed to us over and over and over again. Why don't we live in that expectation from moment to moment? It's because somewhere along the way we've listened to the snake. Peter warns the church not to be that way. He warns them not to discount the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, make every effort to be found spotless, to be found blameless and at peace with him. When he comes, and Peter is saying when he comes, we need to be ready. Make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. See, that is the command of God, and that is the command of God, and it is just as essential to us as the one he gave to Adam and Eve. God meant that one, and he means this one. And God means this now. Make every effort to remain spotless, blameless, and at peace with God. So, how are you doing at spotless these days? How am I? How has your lifestyle been at blameless lately? How is mine? Are you at peace with God or at peace with dozens of ways to justify your actions so you don't have to listen to him? I want to suggest that we each need to look inside for just a few moments with some regularity and ask the Holy Spirit of God to point out areas of unbelief in God's clear commands, unbelief which results in justifications of heart and the fruit of sin. I want to invite you to do something with me. Listen to the words of this prayer. I will return to the beginning of it and invite you to repeat its words aloud, line after line with me, if you feel that you can do so with a genuine heart's conviction. Here's the prayer. Just listen to it the first time. Lord, I realize that I have failed to fully believe your words. I have sometimes listened to false voices. I have often followed my own vices. I have justified my way around obedience to you. And I have failed to live up to your expectations. I will look at your commands with a renewed attention. I will honestly follow after your holy standards. I will seek to live a spotless and blameless life. I will seek to live at peace with you today and every day. Now, if you didn't find anything offensive in there, and if you're willing to repeat those after me, then do so. You're under no obligation to do this. But I'm going to read the line, and then I'll just ask those of you who are willing to repeat it to repeat it. Would you close your eyes, please? Lord, I realize that I have failed to fully believe your words. I have sometimes listened to false voices. I have often followed my own vices. I have justified my way around obedience to you. And I have failed to live up to your expectations. I will look at your commands with a new attention. I will honestly follow after your holy standard. I will seek to live a spotless and blameless life. I will seek to live at peace with you today and every day. Father, I pray for all of these wonderful friends and Christian family members that are gathered in this room with me. I pray that we do better at spotless and blameless. I pray that we do better at believing you when you give us a command and believing that you mean it. I pray that you would help us to take the words of your apostles to heart and take them deep into our own spirits and believe and follow them and love you with all our hearts, souls, and minds. Lord, I pray that as we live our lives with however many days you will continue to give us, that they will be days that will be walked closer to you than ever before. In Jesus' name, amen. So you and I have prayed the benediction, and now Mike's going to lead us in the final song, after which we can leave.
If you are able, please stand and take your insert for my tribute. Should I gain any praise, let it
bless you. Go with him.